Please, if you have questions, well, if you have some urgent question, you can interrupt me. I will be happy if you. Otherwise, at the end of the lecture, I will be happy to answer to all questions. In case later there will be the office hour, or anyway, every time I am in room 103. So, if you want to discuss anything, please come to my office. So, in this course, some basic knowledge of general relativity is assumed, okay? But it will be a very, quite an elementary course. I will start discussing what a gravitational wave is. So, probably many of you will know this first part, but it's better to clarify for everybody. The basic properties of gravitational waves, how they can be observed, how they can be generated by a source, and so the so-called quadrupole formula. Then I will discuss the most interesting source of gravitational waves, the one that has been observed, that is compact binary systems. I will discuss the detection of the signal from this source. And I will briefly describe the existing detectors and also the ones that are planned in the near future. I will then discuss how the waveform can be understood going beyond the quadrupole formula. Of course, while I will be mostly derive the quadrupole formula, in this case I will just say something about the basic concept on how to model with more accuracy, the more advanced, the most advanced modeling of the gravitational wave emission from sources. Then I will discuss the so-called finite size effects. That are the features of the waveform that allow us to distinguish black holes from neutron stars and to understand something about the neutron stars. So I will say something about the multiple moments and the so-called Love numbers. If I don't know if there will be time, so maybe I will also say something about tests of gravity. Tests of general relativity, so how gravitational waves can be used to study the strong field regime and to probe the strong field regime of gravity, mentioning the parameterized approaches, so parameterization of the waveforms that go beyond the general relativity, and the study of classes of theories of possible deviations from general relativity, in particular the simplest and most interesting that are arguably the most interesting that are those with the scalar fields added, let us say, included in the gravitational sector of the theory. But this last part, I don't know if there will be time to enter into it. Now, about the books, there are plenty of textbooks to where these topics are discussed. So, in particular, most of the topics covered can be found in this book. Well, but it's just if you want to find something that goes that reflect closely at least the first parts, the first lectures of this course, which is a group that I did with some colleagues. Relativity and its application, CRC Press. But of course there are many other, and another book that can be very useful for the topics covered in the course is the books of Michele Maggiore. In particular, the first volume, it's in two volumes, but the topics covered here can be found in the first volume, and this is in the Oxford University Press. But there are several books covering, say, advanced topics of general relativity, like the book of Shapiro Teokoski, which is, these are modern, this is somewhat older. It's specifically on compact objects, black holes, white dwarfs, and neutron stars. Even if it is of some decades ago, I think it's black holes, white dwarfs, and neutron stars is this still useful. And also there are books on the basic of general relativity if some of you want to go back and strengthen the basics of general relativity. I would suggest the book of Carroll, this is a modern book on the basic of general relativity. Well, in this first book there are both the basics and the advanced topics. So this is, I think, a very good book on the basics of general relativity. Edison, Wesley. And then there are the most famous and all the references that probably you already know, like the book of Misner, Thorn, Wheeler, and the book of Wald, more formal, a bit more mathematical, which are maybe the most famous book, and also there is a book of Weinberg and many others. These are older books on the basics of general relativity, so they don't really cover the most advanced topics and most modern that I try to discuss in this course. Okay, so let's start. With gravitational waves, as I said, I start from the basics. Only assuming the very basic elementary knowledge on general relativity. So, first of all, general relativity predicts the existence of gravitational waves. This could be expected because, as in electromagnetism, when a distribution of charges changes with time, the corresponding change in the electromagnetic field cannot propagate instantaneously, that would violate causality. And so it propagates through waves moving at finite velocity. Analogously, if you have a distribution of matter and energy that change with time, it affects the gravitational the gravitational field, and this change in the gravitational field has to propagate through a wave moving at finite velocity. Okay? And that's why, just from an early formulation of general relativity, Einstein himself suggested the existence of gravitational waves. Now, even though, as I will mention later, at the beginning the existence of gravitational wave was somewhat controversial, but this was just at the beginning. Now, remember that in general relativity, the gravitational field is described by the metric of the space-time. Okay? So, for this reason, the gravitational waves have to be metric waves. So, gravitational waves are metric waves. They change the proper distance, they change the geometry of space-time. That is, they change the proper distance between nearby points, okay? Nearby events of the space-time. So, just to fix the notation, the metric I write in this way, okay? This is the metric tensor describing, as you know, the measure, the local measure on the space-time manifold. I will use Greek indices as space-time indices running from 0 to 3, Greek letters, and I will use Latin letters, I, J, etc., from 1 to 3 to describe just the space indices. Okay? Now, let us consider in particular not a generic space-time, but a space-time which is a perturbation of flat space-time. So the metric has the form as this form, where eta mu nu is the Minkowski metric, while h mu nu is, and this is the so-called the background, while h mu nu is the perturbation of this background. And we assume that it is small, okay? Note that Minkowski metric can be written, Minkowski spacetime can be described in any coordinate frame. When I say that I use this standard form on the Minkowski metric, it means that I'm also using Minkowskian coordinates. X mu, where x0 is equal to ct, okay, while xi, x1, x2, and x3 are just the space coordinates of a Minkowskian frame, that is, are a Cartesian orthogonal frame, let us say. Okay? Now, this assumption that the metric can be written as a perturbation, or a small perturbation of flat space-time, is called the weak field approximation. And all astrophysical phenomena except those occurring near the surface of a black hole, near a black hole or near a neutron star, all other actual astrophysical phenomena are well described within this approximation, okay? In this approximation, there is an interesting property that, well, I think you know, but I wanted to stress. That is, if you consider, so if we neglect terms quadratic in the metric perturbation with respect to terms of order one, this means quadratic in the components of H mu nu, okay? Then, if you for instance, you consider the metric perturbation, okay, and you want to raise or lower its indexes, well, this is equal to eta alpha mu H mu nu plus order of H squared, because G is equal, even with the upper indexes, is eta plus the terms of order H. So if we neglect this, it means that we can raise and lower indexes of H mu nu with the Minkowski metric. And if we you want to compute the Christoffel symbol, okay, then this is, you all know, for instance, what a Christoffel symbol is and its definition. I'm assuming the basic knowledge of GR. If somebody doesn't know that, please tell me and we can discuss it later in some way. So this is the definition. Now, since the background is constant, here there are the derivatives I can put just H. And since this part is of order H, here I can put just eta, as before, plus order of H squared. And the nice thing is that this is itself of order eta. So the Christoffel symbol are of the order of the perturbation. And this means that if I want to compute, for instance, the covariant derivative, I use the colon for a derivative and semicolon for covariant derivative. I think you know the notation. This is the covariant, the ordinary derivative, plus terms of order with the Christoffel symbol, with the Christoffel symbol plus times a metric perturbation, but this term is of order H squared, which we neglect, okay? This means that the covariant derivative of the metric perturbation is like the ordinary derivative, okay? Why I say these obvious things? Because I want to that you think that in practice, formally, this field H mu nu, or any field of the first order in H, behaves like a tensor field defined in the background space, in Minkowski space-time, okay? So we can treat formally this H mu nu, this tensor H mu nu of X, I write this with this X means X0, X1, X2, X3, like a tensor field defined on M4, the Minkowski spacetime, okay? This is useful because all computation we will do will assume this to be a tensor field over the M4, as long as we are neglecting quadratic terms in the perturbation. And this is not the only tensor of order H. There is another one very important tensor of order H. So consider the stress energy tensor. Now, in general, there is a background part and a perturbation, but we know that it has to solve Einstein's equation . I hope everybody knows Einstein's equation. Now, if we consider the zero order in H of this equation, then you have the background stress energy tensor and the Minkowski metric. But the Minkowski metric, the left-hand side for the Minkowski metric is zero. That is, you cannot have, just to say that T mu nu at zero order in H vanishes. Because if you had a team you knew that exists without when the perturbation is zero, then you could not have eta mu nu as a solution of Einstein's equation. Okay? So this implies that the team you knew is also of order h. So in practice, this is the source of the perturbation. Okay? And this means that also the stress energy tensor can be treated as, so also the stress energy tensor is indices that can be raised and lowered with Minkowski metric, and its covariant derivatives are like ordinary derivatives, as long as we neglect these terms. And so we can formally treat it as a tensor on Minkowski space. And so, so for this tensor on Minkowski space, note that for instance, the indices, the space indices are raised and lowered just with the delta function. So having up and low indices is just the same. Okay, it's very easy to treat systems these tensors because they are for them the rules of special relativity apply. So for instance, this equation satisfied by the stress energy tensor, the covariant the divergence, becomes just this, okay? Because the correction is of order h squared, okay? Good. Now, with all these premises done, if we in the weak field approximation, we take this expansion and replace in the Einstein's equations, okay, no, let me just, maybe, this I can remove this. So if we replace this, so it is a bit lengthy, but conceptually very simple computation, and this gives the Einstein equations. So if we neglecting the order of square terms, so then the Einstein equation, which are usually non-linear equations in the metric, they, if we neglect these terms of h squared, they become linear equations in the perturbation h mu nu. Okay? So this is the so-called linear equation of Einstein's equations. And these linear equations, which are, of course, the difficulty of most of the difficulty of solving Einstein's equation comes from their non-linear character. These are much easier to treat because they are linear equations. This probably most of you have seen it, but it's good too. At this form, where this box F is the F stands for flat because, as I said, only flat space, so only flat metric applies to this tensor. So this is the flat space D'Alembertian operator. It is which is if you replace this, you get, remember that x0 is c times t. This is 1 over c squared. Please tell me if my writing is not clear. Sometimes it happens. Plus nabla squared. Okay, this is the wave, the well-known wave operator. Okay? And we have defined this yh bar, because in order to have this, which is a wave equation with source, you had to change variable and consider the so-called trace reversed metric perturbation, which is a metric perturbation in which you have added the terms proportional h, where h is the trace, h is h alpha alpha, And if you compute the trace of this, you find that the trace of this is the opposite of the trace of H mu nu. So this is the trace reversed perturbation. And in terms of this trace reversed perturbation, you have this equation. A last thing I want to remark, this is a wave. Einstein's equation are this, but what is the second equation? This is a gauge condition, because I remind you that in general relativity, okay, we can, the physics invariant, so all equations are covariant under general coordinate transformations, so you can change coordinates, okay? The freedom of changing coordinate is a gauge freedom. Now, when you are doing perturbation around the background, actually, you are considering a subset of general coordinate transformation. Because if you consider a coordinate change from x mu to x prime mu equal x mu plus a certain function of the coordinates, okay? If epsilon mu of x is of order of h, okay, then this transformation preserves the structure. So you have that in the new coordinates, g prime mu nu is equal to h mu nu plus h prime mu nu. So you still have a background plus a perturbation. And this perturbation is of the same order of h. So if you want to remain in a coordinate system in which the weak field approximation is evident, is explicit, then you have to consider order of h transformation. Now, so you have the gauge freedom of all order of h transformations. This way of to fix this gauge freedom is the so-called harmonic gauge, which in linearized form is just this condition. And why? Because only with this condition, this equation has this simple form. Otherwise, you've had other terms that make the thing less easy to solve. Okay, so this is a gauge condition. Okay, I want also to mention that fixing the harmonic gauge doesn't exhaust the gauge freedom. There is some residual gauge freedom. Indeed, if the coordinates are in the harmonic gauge and you make a transformation such that box flat epsilon mu equals zero, then if you are in the harmonic gauge, you remain in the harmonic gauge. So there is some residual gauge freedom, okay? Now, all this said, let us consider this. So we have these equations. Now, I will consider the solution of this equation in vacuum, because this is where gravitational wave arise. You will find the gravitational wave solution. Later, I will discuss, I don't know if today or in another lecture, I will discuss the solution with the source, so when there is also T mu nu, because in that case, you will see how a given source generates gravitational waves. Now, let's first, in order to understand, I know that probably most of you, well, first of all, anybody has questions about what I said up to now, please feel free to ask any question you have, even in remote. You can just speak up. Is that right? Yes? Sorry, which is the? No, I did. The consequence, well, you can, when you have the solution, you can choose, I will use this, you can choose and restrict more specifically, further restrict the, impose further conditions on the solution that simplify its form, okay? Okay, now let's consider these are linearized Einstein's equations, okay? Let us consider linearized Einstein's equation, so we are assuming the weak field approximation. In the in vacuum, which is stress energy tensor is zero. Okay? Then this becomes box F H bar mu nu equal -1 over C square d square over dt square plus nabla square H bar mu nu equal zero. Now, this is the well-known wave equation that describes wave moving at the velocity of C. These are the gravitational waves, okay? It's, as I said, this equation is linear at variance with the original Einstein's equation. This means that, in this case, like in electromagnetism, the superposition principle holds, and the space of the solution is a vector space. A linear combination of two solutions is the solution, okay? That's very useful, because we can consider a basis in the solution space, and we know all solutions. Now, a useful basis of the solution space is that of the simplest solutions. Is that of plane waves, okay? Of monochromatic plane waves, which has the form H bar mu nu, real part of A mu nu E I K alpha X alpha, where A mu nu is the are constants, okay, is the so-called polarization tensor, while the four vector K alpha is the wave four vector. Okay, so it's a component zero. We call it omega of C. I will explain you immediately why. While the space part, I will use an arrow to indicate the space part of the vector, a traditional three-dimensional vector of Euclidean space. Okay, so this is just the wave vector, okay? Of a wave. Now, why I say that this is omega? Because then this exponential is e to the I k alpha x alpha is equal. So there is a lowering on the index with Minkowski metric to e to the minus I omega t plus I k x. It's just a usual wave as waves that you all know. And if you take this solution and replace in this equation, then you get k alpha equals zero. Okay, so this means that the wave for vector is a null vector. And then replacing this, this that minus omega square over c square plus k square is equal to zero. And then omega, the omega over c is the modulus of the wave vector. And you know that the modulus of wave vector is 2 pi over the wavelength. Okay? So this tells us that the wavelength is equal to 2 pi c over the pulsation. Okay? So, well, I don't want to... Well, you all know how wave... the basics of theories of waves. You know that omega over 2 pi is the frequency of the wave. I just want to specify one thing, that is, what does the gauge condition tell us? The way, if you replace on the gauge condition, you get k alpha a alpha beta equals zero. This means that it is a transverse wave. Okay? And this is a plane wave, of course, the surface of constant phase are planes. Okay? Now, far away from the source, the waveform is, well, is not, of course, that of a plane. If you have a source and you consider the wave generated by the source far away, of course, this is not a plane wave, but locally, if you have an observer far away from the source, which looks around how the wave appears, well, the wave appears as a plane wave, okay? So every wave far away from the source, every gravitational wave, looks locally like a plane wave, okay? So if we choose the x-axis as the propagation, so the direction of the wave, that is the line between the source and the observer, we can always choose to write in a simpler way the solution, we choose the axis in this way, then h bar mu nu is a function of x and t. Do you agree? And in practice, well, that's a propagating wave, so it's h bar mu nu of t minus x over c, because it propagates with velocity c. And now, if we impose the harmonic gauge condition, this set to zero or gives some constraints of some components of this metric. And also, there is this residual gauge freedom that allow to give other conditions of the components of the metric. Now, I do not enter in detail, but what I want to tell you is that it can be shown that it's very easy, it's just for a matter of time that I'm not entering in detail. It can be shown that by imposing the harmonic gauge condition and by a clever use of the residual gauge freedom, it is always possible to impose the following conditions. First of all, that all components with zero are zero. These are four of the 10 independent components of the 4x4 matrix, okay? 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 2, 0, 3 are zero. And also, the four in which one is an x, where x is the direction of the wave, are also zero. Well, this is expected. This is the transversality. We say that there is a transverse wave. Now, and also it is also possible to impose that the trace is zero, okay? Once these conditions are imposed, there is no more residual gauge freedom, and we are in the so-called transverse traceless gauge that for a wave propagating along the x-axis is such that the unique non-vanishing components of the perturbation are h, the one with just a y or z, okay? Because you cannot have neither x and neither t. So are h, first of all, this if the trace is zero, then I don't need this bar, because if the trace is zero, h mu nu is equal to h bar mu nu, okay? Now, the point is that the only components that you have are x, y, y, which is opposite, because the trace has to be zero, to h, z, z, and h, y, z, which is, of course, equal to h, z, y. So there are two independent components. This means that a gravitational wave has 2 degrees of freedom. Not that in general the gravitational field has more than two degrees of freedom, but if you want just a propagating wave, then the gravitational wave has two degrees of freedom. And the TT gauge is useful. This is usually called the TT gauge, transverse traceless, is useful because it makes explicit this fact that there are only two degrees of freedom. Okay, in another gauge, this can be covered by the choice of the coordinates, but in this case it is because we have just two independent components, this which is conventionally called H plus and this which is conventionally called H cross. Okay, so if the wave propagate along the x direction, HTT mu nu, so the perturbation in the transverse traceless gauge has the form as this form, okay? Where the order of the coordinates are t, x, y, z. Okay? This is just the basics, the most elementary properties of gravitational waves. Do you have any questions on this part? Okay, so let us go on, and let us now consider how a gravitational wave can be what happens when a gravitational wave meet or interact with a distribution of matter, which is crucial because this tells us how we can see, we can detect the gravitational waves, okay? Actually, this is subtle because from a naive, as I will show you, from a naive analysis, one may first think that it is impossible to see a gravitational wave, and then this would mean that it has no physical reality, but this is not the case. It was, if one look more in detail, one see that it is possible, and gravitational waves has a very precise effect of matter distribution. So, let us consider some particles at rest in flat space-time, then at a certain point, a gravitational wave passes, okay? So let us consider three particles in flat space-time. Then, at a certain point, the space-time is not flat anymore because a gravitational wave passes. Now, each particle follows is free means with no non-gravitational forces. So each particle follows a geodesic x mu over tau, which is a solution of the geodesic equation. So if u mu is the four velocity, you have the du mu over the tau equal plus gamma mu alpha beta u alpha u beta equal zero. The geodesic equation, I think you all know this equation, okay? So the particle moves on a geodesic. Now let's first see what happens if you have just one particle. Well, if I have one particle, I know that I cannot see the gravitational wave because the equivalence principle states that I can always choose, so for a single particle, I can always choose a local inertial frame, a LIF, a local inertial frame. Sì. Oh, did we make this? So now I am not discussing the generation of gravitational waves, but I'm just discussing if I have this solution in vacuum, so without, so I'm discussing the solution of this equation, okay? So I'm not considering how this was created. I will see this later. I have this wave, and the wave arrives, okay? So the nature of the perturbing source from the point of view of the particle is just this h mu, okay? Now, if I have a single particle, I can always choose a local inertial frame such that the Christoffel symbol are zero in the position of the particle. And so if the particle, the geodesic equation says that if at tau negative, let's say that the wave arrives at tau equals zero, if at negative tau u mu equal 1000, that is the four velocity of a standing particle in flat space, then in this frame u mu remain the same. So the particle does move. And that's because we cannot, in general, in GR, we cannot measure the gravitational field by looking just at one particle, okay? In order to see the gravitational field, you need to look at the relative position between two particles, okay? So let's consider from the beginning two particles. That's trivial in a sense that you can see anything from one particle. Let's consider two particles. Say A and B, okay? Let's choose the TT gauge, okay? So the particles, at tau negative, UA and UB are 1000. Then at tau equals zero, a wave arrives. So if we consider that in the TT gauge, dA square is equal to eta mu nu plus HTT mu nu, dx mu, dx nu, okay? So at tau equals zero, what happens when there is the wave that is arrived? What happens to the particle, okay? Let's solve the geodesic equation. Du mu over d tau of A or B is the same for each of them, is equal to minus gamma mu alpha beta, but u alpha and u beta at tau equals zero have only the zero component, so I can put here zero, zero. Do you agree? And then this is minus 1/2 eta mu nu h nu zero twice h nu zero comma zero minus h zero zero comma nu. But this is the linearized Christoffel symbol, we already seen it. But this, we know that, can you hear me? Yes. You know that there is a question. All the plane wave in phase. No, I'm just considering a single plane wave, not all the plane wave, okay? So in the TT gauge, these are all zero, okay? And so this is zero, because there are zero components here. In the TT gauge, by definition, this is zero. This means that at tau equals zero, the derivative of the four velocity is zero. And so you see the four velocity doesn't change, and in the next time step is the same. So it looks like that u mu, even for tau greater than zero, u mu a is equal to 1000, and u mu b is equal to 1000. And so if I consider the space separation between the particles, the space separation between the particles, delta xi equal xib minus xia. The Latin indexes means that it is a space coordinates, I, j, k, 1, 2, 3. Okay, so sorry, I goes from 1 to 3. These are constant. So one could think naively that the wave has no effect on the position of the particle, but this is not the case. What is the error? The error is that this is a coordinate separation, but the coordinate separation is not an appropriate quantity to find physical effects in generativity, because it depends on the gauge, okay? So in this case, this is the TT gauge, just the unique gauge in which one cannot see the coordinate separation of two particles remain the same when there is a gravitational wave. But this is an artifact of the gauge choice. To be sure, let's compute the proper distance, okay? So if I have two, so the wave moves in the x direction, okay? Imagine that I have two particles, A and B, in the y axis, on the y axis, okay? So the proper distance is you know how to compute the proper distance between two events in general relativity. One has to make the integral of the square root of the metric along that line. So YA, YB, square root of GYY. GYY is 1 plus H plus. So if we say that this is constant in this interval, because the two particles are nearby, this is like YB minus YA square root of 1 plus H plus half, okay? H plus is small, so let me make an expansion, a Taylor expansion, and this is just 1 plus 1 half H plus, okay? Where H plus is a function of T minus X over C, okay? Do you agree? I'm not sure it. Okay. Can you hear me with the microphone? Yes. So you see that this oscillates. So it is true. When a gravitational wave passes, there is an effect that can be seen. Now, which is the appropriate way to describe the relative motion of two particles in general relativity? Well, the appropriate way to describe physical effects in general relativity is through tensor quantities and tensor equations. So in particular, to describe the relative motion of two particles in general relativity, the tensor equation to consider is the geodesic deviation equation that tells us the relative motion of two nearby geodesics, okay? So if I have two geodesics, if, say, U is the four vector, well, let's say that they are is the same in the two geodesics because they are very close, and let's delta X, the four vector of separation of the two geodesics, then there is a quantity that is the geodesic deviation, which is the relative acceleration, which is, well, we denote with this symbol, but it has just a name for this precise definition, which is u gamma, u beta, delta x alpha, semicolon beta, semicolon gamma, okay? So this quantity can be computed easily. These are two four vectors of general relativity, and this is a combination of covariant derivatives. This gives the relative acceleration of the two particles. And the geodesic deviation equation tells that this is equal to the Riemann tensor times u beta, u mu, delta x nu. Okay? Now, in practice, if we want to see, okay, this is the tensor equation, this is the real description, but actual measurements are done in a coordinate frame. So to describe the coordinate frame used in actual measurements, the best way is to choose a local inertial frame, which is not is different from choosing the city gauge. So if we the coordinate frame most suitable to describe what a local observer sees is a local inertial frame, okay? Measurements. By a local observer are performed on a local inertial frame, say xi alpha, centered on one of the particle, say on A. Okay, so we put xi1, xi2, xi3, I don't write xi4 here. Then this is the particle, but there is also the particle A at the origin. The particle B is here, okay? So we want to find in this frame the position of the particle B. Okay, so we say that the space position of xi A is zero, and the space position of xi B is xi, so xi I is xi I. And then, and then, if you take this frame and express the geodesic deviation equation in this frame, again, the computations are easy. You can find the books, but conceptually, there is it's just replacing this frame in this equation and solving the equation. One find that the solution, I just tell you the solution. The solution is that if we call xi I at t equals zero is the initial data, I call it xi I zero, the constants. Then the solution is that xi I of t is equal to xi I zero plus one half delta I j h t t j k xi zero k, okay? Note that we are not in the TT gauge, but the solution can be expressed in terms of the perturbation in the TT gauge, which is the one containing the true degrees of freedom of the gravitational wave. Now, if since this is, you see that since this is, for a plane for a monochromatic plane wave, this is an oscillating term, okay? So if we consider, for instance, well, this is in general, if we consider a plane, a monochromatic, plane wave along x. So in this case, I remind you that this means that h t t I j is equal to 0, 0, 0, 0, h plus and h cross. Okay? If I do this, and if I consider, for instance, a ring of particles living in the YZ plane, circular ring, we can see which is a simple substitution of this, because you have that HTT plus H plus, for instance, is equal to a constant, okay, plus cosine of omega omega T, okay, plus less, plus phi plus, okay. And so you see that in that position you have just a cosine, and with this, and in that position is you have omega t minus x over c less plus phi zero plus, and then you have cosine omega t minus x over c plus phi zero cross. So these are the components of the polarization tensor. So in practice, these are constants that can be zero, can be different from zero. If one, this is zero, H cross and H plus is non-zero, then you have a linearly polarized wave with just the polarization so-called plus. If H plus is zero, H cross is non-zero, you have a linearly polarized wave with polarization cross. In general, you have the combination of the two, okay? Now, what happens if... now, this is a monochromatic wave with a given omega, and so it has a given period, which is 2 pi over omega. What happens then to the circular ring? Well, at tau equals zero, you have the ring, okay? Now, if you have the polarization plus, if you have the plus polarization, after one fourth of the period, the ring, just a simple replacement of this expression here, you can easily find that the ring becomes an ellipse. Then, after half of the period, you have again the ring. And after another half, you have another ellipse, okay? This is for the plus polarization. If you have instead the cross polarization, you have the same thing, but rotated 45 degrees. Okay, and this gives you an idea of what is the effect of a gravitational wave on matter, okay? Okay, I think it can be useful if we take just 10 minutes of stop, so please don't go, don't move too much because I want to restart just in 10 minutes, okay? Any questions? Or you can take also this time to make questions if you prefer. Okay. From remote, any question? No. Let's restart. Now, to observe the gravitational waves, the best, the unique wave that... Io qua sono acceso. Mi sentite? Can you hear? Okay. So the way to detect gravitational waves is through the Michelson interferometers. That is an instrument whose basic concept I think everybody knows, because it's the same basic, it's the same instrument that has been used in 100 and in the end of 19th century to in the famous Michelson and Morley experiment leading to the formulation of special relativity. So you have a source. Of light, well, this is the old way. You have a beam splitter,
that separate the beam in two parts, then there are mirrors. Then the two beams join and they are revealed by a detector. Today, gravitational wave detectors like LIGO and Virgo have the same concept, but of course they are much, much more sophisticated because you have a laser light. Light goes not just to a mirror and back, but goes back and forth hundreds of times through the so-called Fabry-Perot cavities. And the detector is not just a screen, it is a photodetector, but the idea is the same, okay? So, imagine that you have a gravitational waves in the x direction, and imagine that the two arms are in the y and z plane, okay? Let's assume for simplicity a monochromatic wave, okay, with a certain frequency omega. And again, for simplicity, imagine that you have just the plus polarization. So the only non-vanishing components are h yy equal minus h zz equal h plus cosine of omega t minus x over c, okay? These are the unique non-vanishing components of the metric. So the idea is that when the gravitational wave passes, the length of this arm change, and so the path of the two light rays differ. The difference between the paths changes, and you can see this in the detector, where there is a interference. Now, a possible objection that often people raise is, well, but you have a change of length of an arm, but you also have the same change of length of the wavelength. So, when the gravitational wave passes, the number of wavelength in an arm is the same. So, are we sure that we really see a gravitational wave? Now, the answer to this question is yes, we see a gravitational wave, because even though it is true that the number of wavelength in the arm does not change, what changes is the time needed for the ray to go through its path. Let's see. Let's compute the time, okay? You will see that the gravitational waves determine a time delay in the path of the ray, and then of the beam, and then this leads to a dephasing between the two beams. So we have the metric. If you have just the plus polarization, you have the metric is ds square equal which is then minus dt square plus dx square plus 1 plus h plus dy square plus 1 minus h plus dz square, z square. Okay? Let L0 be the length of the arm, and we say that omega the gravitation wave frequency. Okay? Not to be confused with the omega of omega electromagnetic of the light. There are two frequencies. There is the frequency of the light and the frequency of the gravitational wave. Okay? But let omega be the frequency of the gravitational wave. And now let's make a simplifying assumption let's assume that the wavelength of the gravitational wave equal to 2 pi c over omega is much smaller, larger than L0, okay? I will come back later on this assumption. This makes the things simpler because this means that in this space, in this scale, the H plus is constant, okay? It doesn't change significantly. And so the computation, so H plus nearly constant through the arm. Okay, now we have a light ray going along y. It follows a geodesic. So for the light ray, if you want to find, to find the motion of the light ray, we have to find the null geodesic. So ds square for the light ray along y, so z is constant, so the z is zero, the x is zero, you just have the ds square is equal to minus c square dt square plus 1 plus h plus dy square. Do you agree? And this is zero because it is a light ray. This tells us that dt is equal to 1 over c square root of 1 plus h plus the y, okay? Since h plus is small, this is 1 over c, 1 plus 1 half h plus the y, okay? And then since we said that h plus is constant through the arm of the interferometer, then we have that we can integrate this, and you have that the time, the back and forth time on the y arm is, let's call it ty, okay, is the integral of this going back and forth for the in the path L0 twice. So is 2L0 over C 1 plus 1 half H plus. Do you agree? Okay, please stop me if you have some doubts. If you do the same on Z arm, it is the same with the difference that on the Z arm you have a minus H plus, and so you have that TZ is equal to L0 over C 1 minus H plus half. And then when the two beams join, there is a time delay, which is the difference between these two time. Delta T is equal to TY minus TZ is equal to 2L0 over C H plus. Okay? So the gravitational wave leads to a time delay and then to a shift in space. C delta T is equal to L0 H plus, okay? If large enough, this shift can be detected. That's the idea. Actually, I made an assumption, this, but I was a bit cheating because this assumption is not really satisfied in actual interferometers, only marginally. So, in actual interferometer. L0 is smaller but not so much smaller of lambda JW. Okay? So this computation the computation is a bit more complicated because you have a to do real integration, but I mean it's just again it's conceptually very simple. You can find in books, but it's just for a matter of time that I don't do the derivation. I just give the result, which is that C, if you take into account this, then you have the C delta T is equal to L0 H plus times a factor which is 1 in that limit, which is sin of omega L0 over C over omega L0 over C. Now, why I'm showing you this? Because for a given omega, while this formula for a given omega, the larger is L0, the larger is the shift, in this case is not true anymore. Here, for a given omega, there is a maximum value of L0, for which the shift is larger. So, given omega, C delta T maximum if, well, omega 0 over C equal pi half, okay? But which means that well, omega 0 over C is also equal, omega over C is 2 pi over lambda, so you have 2 pi over lambda GW L0 equal pi half, which means that L0 is equal to lambda GW 4. So, the best the interferometer best suited to detect radiation, gravitational radiation with this wavelength has this length. So let's make some example. So let's consider LIGO Virgo. Or Virgo. Well, they have L0 is technically is for the real length of the arm is 4 kilometers, but as I said, the radiation goes back and forth hundreds of times before being detected. So the effective length of the arm is 750 kilometers. Okay? So the best, so this is best suited for to detect ...3,000 kilometer wavelength, which means a frequency which is C over lambda, of course. So 300,000 over 3,000 is 100. So 100 Hz. Which is indeed a very, very rough, very back on the envelope computation, which tells us which is the scale of the wave that we expect to detect with LIGO Virgo, of the frequency of the wave, which is of the order 100 Hz. And indeed, if one makes, well, in reality, I will show this, there are, one has to take into account a source of noise, a lot of things, but this is roughly the best the frequency at which LIGO and Virgo are most sensitive, or the order of magnitude, let us say. Another case, so the space detector is a space detector, LISA, that is planned, it will be launched by ESA and NASA, it will be launched in 2037, hopefully. I will go back to this, but there are satellites, and with the laser ray among them, with laser rays, so the length of the arm is the distance between the satellites, which is 2.5 millions kilometers. And the same computation gives 10 to the minus 2 hertz, which is roughly the frequency that we expect to observe with this detector. Okay? Yes. From, but I didn't do the derivation, but from the fact that this assumption is L0 is not negligible with respect to lambda. So when you do but when you have the differential relation, okay, I made the integral just adding the difference of the variables, so integration variables. Instead, you wanted to make a proper integral. If you make the proper integral, then you find this. You can find the derivation in the Majores book, that is one of the ones that I mentioned at the beginning, okay? Okay, this closes the part about the detection. Well, I will speak a lot later about gravitational wave detectors, but in this first part of the course, that's enough for the detection. And now I want to speak about gravitational wave generation. So, how a given source generates gravitational waves. Now, the equation, the linearized Einstein's equation, so in the weak field, again, weak field, in weak field limit, so in which we can write the metric as eta mu nu plus h mu nu, where h mu nu is small, okay? We have seen that linearized Einstein's equation with source, before we are setting the equal to zero, are this, okay? Let's solve this equation with source. Now, this is the standard wave equation, so you know how to solve the standard wave equation with sources. Using the Green function, solution of so delta of t, this Green function, the solution of this is, as you I'm sure know, minus 1 over 4 pi x delta of t minus, okay. Now, over C, I think that. Now, if with a simple step by integrating the solution, one can find the solution in terms of retarded potentials. I don't give the steps because in electrodynamics it is exactly the same. So the solution is so there is a minus 1 over 4 pi, so there is a 4g over c to the 4. Now we'll explain in more detail this formula. Let's understand more in detail this expression, which is very important. So this is the idea. You have the source. Okay? In the source we put the origin of our coordinate system. The source is where the stress energy tensor is non-zero. we have an observer in a certain position. Which is in a position x. So the observer wants to measure h bar mu nu of t of tx, okay? So this is the vector x then, the three vector x, okay? So we want to find the solution at time t at the position x. To do this, of course, we make an integral over the source. Let's see that the volume of the source is a volume that encloses the source, okay? And each small element of the source is at the position x prime, okay? And this small element is, of course, at a distance x minus x prime from the observer. So you see that the solution in this point is the integral of the contribution for all the infinitesimal volume element of the source. Each infinitesimal volume element contributes with the source computed at the retarded time, so the time t minus the distance of the volume element from the observer, at the position x prime of the volume element, over again, the separation x minus x prime because of the Green function, okay? That's the the condition of, the condition on H, yes, because here I am assuming weak field, which means, so the point is, the weak field condition is of course a condition that is not valid in strong field sources. So this formula that I will derive is simplified, is a formula that is valid in some cases, but in some other is approximate, okay? It is an approximation. The approximation that you have a weak field also on the source. It will be trivial to assume that there is weak field far away from the source, because even if the source is very strong, you always, whatever is the source, if you go far away from the source, the weak field condition is always satisfied. The weak field condition, which is very important, let me, is always satisfied far away from the source. But now I am assuming that it is satisfied also on the source, okay? Good. Now, my assumptions are, of course, weak. Weak field, so also on the source. Then I'm interested in the gravitational wave far away from the source. So we assume that the observer is far away from source. How can I write it quantitatively? Well, I can consider the length of the linear dimensions of the source, which, for instance, I can consider V, the volume V of integration, to be a sphere that centered the origin, okay, on the source, but that, well, with radius epsilon, okay? The important thing of this volume V is that it has to be support on the source, which means that T mu nu equals zero, not only outside the volume, but also on its boundary. Okay, I will require this. And epsilon is the linear dimensions of the source. For instance, the radius of a sphere, assuming that V is a sphere, okay? Now, what does it mean to say that the observer is far away from the source? That if we compute R as the modulus, the Euclidean modulus of the vector between the source and the observer, we are assuming that R is much larger than epsilon. Okay, we always assume this. If in all sources this is enormously well satisfied, okay? Because we have astronomical distance, cosmological distance sources, and the sources are of, well, kilometers or millions of kilometers, most, but. So this is very well satisfied, much more than all the others. And then there is, I want to simplify this by making a further assumption that I will discuss this when I will discuss how to go beyond this formula. But for now, let's make this assumption. I assume that epsilon is much smaller than lambda wavelength of gravitational waves. Okay, so I'm assuming that the wavelength of the gravitational waves are much larger than the dimensions of the source. This means that lambda is equal to 2 pi c over omega, you remember? And the c over omega over 2 pi is the frequency, nu. So is c over nu, okay? So we are really asking that epsilon nu is much smaller than c. Now, what is epsilon nu? Epsilon is the scale of distance of the source. Nu is the frequency of the gravitational wave, but the gravitational wave is frequency related to the frequency of the motion of the source that emits the gravitational wave. So we can say that 1 over nu is the time scale of the motion on the source. Do you agree? And so epsilon nu is the length of the source over the time scale of the motion is the order of magnitude of the typical velocity of the source. For this reason, let me write here, saying that this and so this means that V is much smaller than C. Okay, so what we are saying with this hypothesis is that V, the typical velocity of the source, has to be much smaller than C. For this reason, this approximation, epsilon much smaller than lambda, which is together to H mu nu, G mu nu equal eta mu nu plus H mu nu with H mu nu much smaller than 1 and with this other, okay, these 3, 1, 2 and 3, the third one is equivalent to this. For this reason, the third hypothesis is called the slow motion approximation. Note that slow means slow with respect to the light speed, so it's not so, well, we will see that it can be violated, but it's not so restrictive. We are just saying that typical velocities of the source are non relativistic, okay? Now, with this hypothesis, if we consider this this formula, with this hypothesis, now the first simplification is simple, because x prime for definition is smaller of epsilon, and so x minus x prime modulo dx is equal of r, since r is much larger than epsilon, this is of the order of r. Okay? Now, I will come back to, one could just say that h bar, this implies, with this approximation, this is enough to say that h bar mu nu of tx is equal to 4g over c to the 4 r, t mu nu of t minus r over c x prime d3x prime. Now, there is a subtlety that I will discuss in a later lecture, that even if it may appear that this is sufficient to go from here to here, actually you also need the slow motion approximation. So you need that epsilon is much smaller than lambda. And the reason is that, I will show you that this part, putting this outside of the integral is easy, but the fact that t mu nu depends on the time, the fact that this is a small correction of this is not sufficient to remove it. But let's take this for granted. I will go back to this in a later lecture. For the moment, let's believe that you have this, but this exists is allowed because we have assumed both source far away from the observer and slow motion approximation, besides, of course, the weak field approximation. And then, okay, 10 minutes. And then, this formula can be simplified again, because you remember that I said that t mu nu comma nu equal to zero. Now, I will show you the sort of steps which are conceptually very simple to simplify this formula more. So this says that 1 over c d over dt t mu 0 equal to minus t mu I over dxi, where I runs from 1 to 3, okay? Let's integrate this over the volume. Mu 0, this is 0, mu 0. Do you agree? D3, this is do you agree? Okay. Now, this is the integral of the three volume of a space divergence. Okay? So we can apply the Gauss theorem and say that this is the integral on the boundary, on the surface around V, of T mu I times, here there is a bit of mess with this picture, but so I have the volume V, where there is the source, and then if you have n, the normal vector orthogonal to the source, this is T mu I, ni, ds, where ds is the surface integral. This is Gauss theorem, okay? But this is zero, because t mu nu equals zero on the boundary of V, okay? So we have learned that, the time derivative of this integral is zero. So we have learned that is constant, okay? T mu zero, this is T mu zero, sorry. This is zero, okay? Do you agree? And then, if we replace there, we have that h bar mu 0 equal 4g over c to the 4 r integral of t mu 0 of t minus r over c x prime d3 x prime. Even if this integrand depends on t, the integral is constant, okay? So this is constant. We found an important, this is a zero, an important relation, okay? Now, remember that I told you that the space of solution of this equation, since it's a linear equation, is a vector space. So I can decide that I'm interested in a subspace of the solution of this space. So I want to study gravitational waves, so I'm not interested in constant perturbations. So I can just consider the oscillating part of the solution. I'm allowed to do this because of the superposition principle. So I only consider oscillating solution, and so I'm allowed to consider solutions in which this constant is zero. So I found that 4 of the 16 components, if I only consider the oscillating part of the general solution of the equation, are zero. And what about the other? Well, there is a long and very elementary derivation. Actually, if you want, I can also show you, but it takes some time. If you ask me, I will show you, but I don't think there is a lot to learn on that step. So it's just the same step as this. So take the stress energy tensor, maybe times some components of the X, use this condition, make integrals, apply the Gauss theorem, and the fact that the stress energy tensor is zero on the boundary, and one can find other relations. In particular, one can find the so-called tensor virial theorem. But behind that, there is nothing more that this kind of proof as the one that I just did, showing that the integral of Tij d3x is equal to 1 over 2c square second time derivative of the integral of t00 xi xj d3x. Okay? And this is very important because, so if I have these four components, I need the other six components, h bar ij. Okay? And h bar ij are just one over two c square, d square over dt square, because it is the integral of Tij, okay, but the integral of Tij is just the integral of t00 in the retarded time xi, x prime j, d3 x prime. Okay? That's much easier to compute because if I have a source, it is difficult to know the components of the stress energy tensor, but I know what is the 0,0 component. Also because I am in weak field, so Minkowski space-time, small velocity, so special relativity, what is special relativity with small velocity? It's Newtonian theory. So in the Newtonian limit, Newtonian physics applies on the source, okay? 1 over c square of t00, t00 is a mass energy density divided by c square, so a small velocity is the rest energy density, over c square is equal to the matter density. And so I found that, well, let me write this. I have found the so-called, so, that if I define the quadruple moment of the source which is a quantity characterizing the entire source, is just a function of time. Qij, function of time, equal 1 over c square rho of tx xi xj d3x. That's just the definition. Then I have the so-called quadruple formula. That is that in the weak field slow motion limit, the gravitation wave far away from the source is h bar mu 0 equal to 0, h bar ij of t and r is equal to, I wrote it, so 1 over c square goes, because t 0 0 over c square gives the matter density, so you have 4g over 2 over c to the 4th r, so 2g and then I have the second derivative of what is just, so written this way is just a function of time, so is the total second derivative of qij computed at the retarded time. This is the quadruple formula, okay? Typically, interesting remark, if you compute g over c to the 4, this is g over t to the 4 is an incredibly small number, is just 10 to the minus 49 second square over gram times centimeter cube. So this is divided by r, which is the distance from the source, okay, and the observer. So you, of course, you have to multiply by an astronomical object, but you can imagine, so for instance, the mass of the sun is 10 to the 33 grams. But I mean, if you multiply with something which is on the scales of the source, you can expect that since here you have 10 to the minus 49, you can expect that the gravitational waves are typically very weak. This is just an intuitive remark, but we will make actual computation. We will see that indeed gravitational waves are very weak. So I think that for today it's time to stop. Any question? At home, at in remote, you can also speak up and ask, even without the chat, if you have any question. Okay. Okay, I think that's it. Goodbye, and see you tomorrow. Anzi, scusa, l'office hour di oggi lo faccio io. So, no, today there is the office hour of my course, which in practice how it is organized that I am in my office, but no, or it's here, no. I answer in remote, or it's physically here or in the office? Because I answer in remote to all questions and also in presence, no, that's the idea. So, it's here, so. Okay. So, two questions. I'm here open to answer questions in general, but in particular during the office hour this afternoon. Also in remote. Okay, goodbye. si chiude qua.